Today, we will weave this thread through the motions of dance, the warps and wefts of textiles, and finally through the delights of Indian cuisine. Mrs. Aishwarya Hegde will be on stage here to enlighten us about classical dance, whilst Mrs. Mrinal Khimji will be at home talking to us, throwing some light on Indian textiles. Now, Aishwarya grew up in Oman, learning the dance form of Odissi. She devoted her time, energy, and resources to what is not just a skill or profession for her. It is a passion. Mrinal, on the other hand, used her skills and a passion for textiles and sustainable products to build a profession. Both these ladies could follow their interests, spread their culture in a foreign land, only because Oman is an open, inviting, and tolerant country. For this, I'm immensely grateful to His Majesty, the late Sultan Qaboos, for his inclusive vision. He did not just commission grand and beautiful buildings like the Royal Opera House. He truly encouraged individual pursuits of culture. I would also like to thank His Majesty Sultan Haitham bin Tariq, whose leadership continues to take Oman forward and become even more diverse and inclusive. And that's why in modern Oman, both Aishwarya and Mrinal, who are mothers, can do the balancing act of running a dance academy and a boutique respectively. India and Oman have been old friends. As nations, we've supported each other through thick times and through thin times. And as a people, we have grown fonder of each other. Oman and India are an example to the world. We have both chosen to see the commonalities of humanity, textile, jewelry, and our love for biryani. Instead of quibbling over the differences of language, geopolitics, and the types of halwa, ours is different. So I'd like to first thank my husband for encouraging me to do this event. And then I would like to really, really thank my team from the embassy, without whom this event would not be possible.
So much, Mrs. Narang, for those lovely words. Classical dance is more than just music and body movements. I would now like to invite Aishwarya to throw some light on this and on other deeper facets of dance.
Good morning, ladies. It is a privilege and an honor to be standing in front of such an august gathering. My team and I are extremely grateful to the Indian Embassy and particularly Mrs. Divya Narang for giving us this platform to share our art with you today. I am Aishwarya Hegde, an Odissi performer. I spent all of my childhood and most of my adult life here in Oman. Here is where I was trained in this beautiful dance form, Odissi. Joining me in my lecture demonstration today are two of my dancers, Varsha Rati and Kavya Reddy. They will assist me through this demonstration. Today, I'm going to walk you through the journey that Odissi has made from the ancient temples of Orissa to platforms all over the world, such as this. We will then move on to explore the grace and fluidity of this art form and understand the relevance of Odissi in today's time. We will conclude our presentation with a performance. India is a culturally diverse country, with each part of India speaking different languages and following different cultural ethnicities. This has given rise to 8 different classical dance forms in India, each one from a different region of the country. Odissi comes from the eastern state of Odisha. We'll start with the different aspects of the history of Odissi. And I would first like to start with the ancient scriptures from which dance originated. The second aspect would be the Devdasi tradition. And the third are the temples of Orissa. All Indian classical dance forms find their roots in ancient texts of India. These are palm leaf manuscripts that were dated back to the 5th century. This was a highly codified language of how to use the eyes, the feet, the movements of the body to express different emotions. And this scripture was called the Natya Shastra. Natya meaning dance, and Shastra meaning way of life. So this was a way to adapt dance as a way of life. The temples of India are truly the gems of our heritage. And I would like to talk particularly about one of these temples, which is the Konark Sun Temple. This temple was conceived to be the chariot of the sun god. There is no idol or deity inside this temple because it was believed that the first ray of sunlight would fall into the inner sanctum of the temple. The chariot is pulled by 24 wheels spread around the chariot, denoting the 7 days, 24 hours of the day, pulled by 7 horses that denote 7 days of the week. If you see closely, the temple carries murals of sculptures all around them. Here's another picture for a better view. You can see sculptures of dancers all around the walls of this temple. There are hundreds and hundreds of sculptures spread around it. Odissi was recreated looking at all of these sculptures. A focused study of these sculptures gives us an understanding of the postures and the intricacies that went into making each one of them, only to give us an evidence that dance flourished heavily during this period of time in India. I would now like to call my dancers to demonstrate some of the postures that are inspired by these statues. So we first like to demonstrate postures of dancers holding different instruments. So the first instrument is called the veena, which is a string instrument which looks similar to the guitar. So it has a throat and it has the stomach, which is in the lower part. And the second instrument is the wind instrument, which is the flute, the shringara, where the dancer shows a top knot in her hair. And the second posture is the darpani, where the dancer looks into the mirror, admiring her beauty while she lays flowers in her hair. Thank you, girls. Even the aesthetics of Odissi finds its roots in the temples of Orissa. If you can see the headgear that we're all wearing, it's very unique to Odissi, and no other classical dance form carries this headgear. It's made of two parts. The circular part that goes around the hair knot is inspired by the Konark wheel from the Konark temple, and the elongated part above my head is inspired by the Shikhara or the Minara from the Jagannath Puri temple, also in Odisha. An Odissi dancer carries a lot of tension in her body. If you see at this moment, if I press on any side of her body, she's going to hold her posture in place. Even if I lay my weight on her, it's difficult to disbalance her because she's carrying her whole weight completely balanced on both legs. This posture is called the Chauka. The second posture is called the Tribhanga. The Tribhanga means 3 bends of the body. The first bend in the knees, the second in the deflection of the torso, and the third in the neck. The Tribhanga is a highly complex posture where the entire body weight is balanced on one leg. So the dancer is only carrying her weight on one leg while the other leg is loose to move around. So whether she places her foot on the floor or on her toe away in the air, it is balanced on one leg. So the dancer is only carrying her weight on one leg while the other leg is loose to move around. So whether she places her foot on the floor or on her toe away in the air, up here or at the back, it makes no difference to the rest of the body because she is now practiced to balance her whole weight on one side. If you see the two postures, you'll notice that one of the postures is completely masculine in nature and the second posture is more feminine and is like an S. We now like to demonstrate one step in both of these postures to give you an idea of how we dance in them. I'd like to do it in a fashion of layering so you can see how we work opposing factors while we dance.
Ta ti na ker ti dorso ta ta ti na ker ti hands ta ta ti na ker ti neck ta ta ti na ker ti knees ta.
So a classical Odissi dancer is constantly working opposing motions
If we hit the right leg, our torso moves to the left side, our eyes move to the right side, and our hands move to the left side. So it's a constant work of the mind and body while we're dancing. Thank you. Dance, it's a form of prayer. There was no public or audience to watch this dance. It was sacredly only believed to be a form of prayer. This tradition was patronized and funded by the royal families of Orissa. But with multiple invasions, with the downfall of kingdoms, and finally with the colonization of India by the British, the Devadasi tradition came to an end. And that's how Odissi ceased to exist. This dance form was completely abolished at that point in time, and then was revived as recently as the 1950s. So Odissi is considered to be the oldest Indian dance form, but also the newest revived dance form. Dance isn't just one thing. Dance is a tapestry of many layers. We need a poem, we need one couplet for poem, and we imagine an outworldly space. We imagine characters, we draw storylines. Dividing of a time, dividing time into different intervals is what Taal is. Life itself is a division of time. We take time and we divide it into years, months, days, hours, minutes and seconds. And that's exactly what we do with dance. We take a time interval and decide how many little intervals we are going to divide it in. What I was reciting while they were dancing is the Taal. A deep understanding of Taal is what gives us synchronization while we dance together. So now we are going to do a little exercise where we are going to learn how to recite the Taal together. So you can repeat after me. Ta. Ta. Ta-ti.
Ta-ti.
Naka.
Naka.
Tini.
Tini.
Okay. Another way to say the Taal is, you will clap at ta, ta,
ta.
You will touch your forefinger to your thumb, ta-ti.
Ta-ti.
Your middle finger to your thumb, naka.
Naka.
Your ring finger to your thumb, tini.
Tini.
Ta.
Ta.
Ta. Ti. Naka. Tini. Ta. Ta. Ti. Naka. Ti. Ni. Ta. Ta. Ti. Na. Ka. Ti. Ni. Great. So you see, we formed a rhythmic pattern. And now the dancers are going to dance while we perform the Taal for them. Shall we start? 1, 2, 3. Let's go. Ta. Ta. Ti. Na. Ka. Ti. Ni. Ta. Ta. Ti. Na. Ka. Ti. Madhya. Ta. Ta. Ti. Na. Ka. Ti. Ni. 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 Ta. So if you notice, we maintain the same Taal while they dance faster. That is called lekar. So the same time interval gets divided into faster and slower tempo while we dance. That was really good. We'd now like to demonstrate, all the steps that we demonstrated so far were very stationary in nature. And now we'd like to show you how a dancer uses space on stage. And just for variety, instead of saying ta, ta, ti, na, ka, ti, ni again, I'm just going to change the notation, but the Taal remains exactly the same. Prida, Dekta, Ti, Nakati, Ni, Ta. Tata, Ti, Nakati, Ni, Ta. Prida, Dekta, Ti, Nakati, Ni, Ta. Tata, Ti, Nakati, Ni, Ta. Prida, Dekta, Ti, Nakata. Tata, Ti, Nakata. Dekta, Ti, Nakati, Ni, Ta. Prida, Dheta ti nakati ni ta ta ti nakati ni dheta ti nakati ni ta krida thagda ti nakati ni ta. So this was called a chari. This is just the use of space. We are still holding the body in the same bhangi, the one leg bhangi that we showed you before, the bhangi. And this was how you moved in that. And now we're going to show you one more little part. Dhe tati nitsi na. Kar tak tati nitsi na. Dhag dhati nitsi na. Kar tak dhati nitsi madhyam. Dhe tati nitsi na. Kar tak dhati nitsi na. Dhag dhati nitsi na. Kar tak dhati nitsi dhrit. Dhe dhati nitsi na. Kar tak dhati nitsi na. Dhag dhati nitsi na. Kar tak dhati nitsi na. Dhe. All of this was a part of pure dance, and now we move on to the second aspect of classical dance, which is abhinaya. Abhinaya is storytelling. Abhinaya is denoting an emotion. We use a codified language to express an emotion and draw a storyline with the audience. All of these are snippets of a live performance. If you see the first picture, which is up here, is of me listening to music while the other dancer is playing the flute. This is me being consoled by another dancer. This is us gossiping. And this is me shocked by the guts of a male dancer trying to touch me while I'm performing on stage. So abhinaya is a highly complex code of your eyes, your hands, your body movements, your gesture to draw a storyline and to put an emotion out so the audience gets it. We are going to demonstrate how we use our hands to express emotions. So a single mudra or a single hand gesture can mean many things. We are going to show you how the dhyana mudra or the hamsashya can show you different meanings. The first meaning can be sitting in meditation. The second could be of breathing or life itself. The third is of listening to sweet music, plucking flowers, or smelling a flower. This is a single hand mudra. We also have conjunctive hand mudras, which are hands which are connected to each other. This mudra is called the Karkata. The Karkata can be used to show waiting in anticipation, just stretching in days, a feeling of dejection or rejection, or simply resting on a friend and chatting. I'd like to demonstrate a small little piece to draw a storyline for you. I remember the time that you and I shared together. I hold it in my heart and keep it there like a secret. So this is how we use gestures to communicate our language to the audience. And this entire piece is called abhinaya. An Odissi dancer is constantly balancing opposing forces. She might be balancing strength with fluid grace. She might be balancing concepts like spirituality and sensuality when she dances on stage. She might be balancing an inner exploration of the self while exuberating an outer performance to the audience. But the one I find most challenging is to find the balance between tradition and modernity. Collaboration has been one such tool which has been very helpful to strike this balance. And to convince you on this point, I'd like to take the help of another artist. That is an Odissi dancer with Michael Jackson, but now I don't think it's going to be easy to forget. While Michael Jackson gave Odissi an international platform that is now etched in our memories forever, what is to take away from this video is that art speaks a universal language. Odissi transitioned from the temples of Odisha and moved into auditoriums for an audience to experience. And today, Odissi is going through a second wave of transition, where it is moving from auditorium spaces to more intimate gatherings and to the virtual platform. When we at Deepam were trying to explore the possibilities that a virtual platform offers us, we unanimously agreed that we wanted the beautiful landscapes of Oman to be a part of every one of our videos. These are snippets of all videos that we've shot in different parts of Oman. I'm sure you can recognize many of these places. Requires years of disciplined training and an audience to support it. We dancers believe that Odissi can communicate with a universal audience at a human level. Performing in art galleries, fashion show openings, and corporate events, or even conducting lecture demonstrations such as this, is our humble attempt to form a closer connection with our audience. In every performance, we respect the cultural and traditional values of Oman while maintaining the purity of this ancient Indian dance form. We would like to conclude our demonstration with a performance by Varsha and myself. We have tried to incorporate all the elements of dance that we spoke about during this lecture demonstration, and we hope that it's more relatable to you today. Thank you once again for being such a wonderful audience.